Over in Ukraine, Kyiv falling into darkness following Russia's second big attack on Ukraine's energy infrastructure this month. Officials said 9 regions are suffering from damaged energy infrastructure facilities, warning of at least 12 hours of power interruption for some residents. Russian President Vladimir Putin said the strike had been Moscow's response to Ukraine's attack on Russian territory using America's missiles. Over 1 million people reportedly lost electricity in Ukraine in the immediate aftermath of the Russian strikes. Australia passes a law banning social media for children aged under 16. The law, expected to take effect in November 2025, sets some of the toughest social media controls in the world and will force platforms to take reasonable steps to ensure age verification protections are in place. After a parliamentary session that stretched late into the evening, the Senate voted to pass the law earlier approved by the House.
World-leading action to make sure social media companies meet their social responsibility. Social media is doing harm to our children. And today, as a direct result of our legislation passed through the Parliament yesterday, through the Senate and confirmed in the House today, parents can have a different discussion with their young ones, a different discussion that will result in better outcomes and less harm for young Australians. Platforms now have a social responsibility to ensure the safety of our kids is a priority for them.
Critics of the bill, however, called it weak and only gives a false sense of security.
It's also obvious that the people who have drafted and fought for the particular elements of this bill actually have no idea how young people engage with the internet. Yeah. Absolutely no idea. I mean, it's almost embarrassing. I mean, this is boomers trying to tell young people how the internet should work.
Social media is such a prevalent part in young people's lives and how people socialize and interact with each other and keep in contact and build relationships with each other. And with such like a clear-cut ban, I believe that it will only create a generation of young people who will be more technologically literate in bypassing these like walls and things that will be used to deter young people from using it by using fake ages and fake identification, and won't achieve the desired effects.
In separate submissions, Google and Meta say the ban should be delayed until government concludes its planned age verification trial. TikTok says the bill needs more consultation, while X argues the proposed law might hurt children's human rights. Cracks appear in the Israel-Hezbollah ceasefire, with both sides accusing each other of violating the deal aimed at halting over a year of fighting. Israel says its Air Force struck a facility used by Hezbollah to store mid-range rockets in southern Lebanon. Israel also says it opened fire on suspects with vehicles arriving at several areas in the southern zone, saying it was a breach of the truce. The Lebanese army later accused Israel of violating the deal several times on Wednesday and Thursday. The exchange of accusations highlights the fragility of the ceasefire, which was brokered by the U.S. and France. The truce lasts for 60 days in the hope of reaching a permanent cessation of hostilities. U.S. President Joe Biden hoping his successor will rethink his plan to impose tariffs on America's biggest trading partners. President-elect Donald Trump said on Monday he would impose a 25% tariff on Canadian and Mexican imports until they clamp down on drugs and migrants crossing the border. The move would appear to violate the U.S.-Mexico-Canada free trade deal.
We have an unusual situation in America. We're surrounded by the Pacific Ocean, the Atlantic Ocean, and two allies, Mexico and Canada. And the last thing we need to do is begin to screw up those relationships. I think we've got them in a good place. I think by the way, the cooperation with the outgoing president and the incoming president, the illegal crossings are down considerably to what they were back in when he was in office. There's a lot more to do, but I just think, I hope they reconsider.
Meanwhile, Mexico's President Claudia Sheinbaum says she and Trump had agreed to maintain a good relationship in a friendly phone call that appeared to ease tensions. Following the call, Trump said Sheinbaum had agreed to stop migration through Mexico, effectively closing the southern border. A bionic knee and ankle system wins big at a biotech competition and may soon help people with motor disabilities. Take a look.
This is Cybathon, a competition showing technology for those with motor disabilities. As he maneuvers across a balance beam, Andrea Modica is wearing one of this year's top winners, the Omnia. The bionic system consists of two motorized components, Unico, the knee, and Armonico, the ankle. Its makers say its unique composition helps its users feel a more natural walk while keeping them safe from falls. The Unico knee combines hydraulic and electric technology. The hydraulic system is used for level walking or descending. The electric technology helps its user during tasks like climbing stairs or standing from a seated position. Samuele Di Giuseppe is with the Italian Institute of Technology, the makers behind the Omnia.
This strategy allows for a more physiological walk, allowing the patient to feel safer and a reliable system during the everyday life activities.
The Armonico ankle features an innovative screw mechanism that reduces heel impact and prevents tripping. Di Giuseppe says the device is fully customizable for the user.
Thanks to the sensor present on this system, the prosthetic device is able to adapt itself during the walk, allowing for a smoother transition and reducing the risk of stumbling for the patient.
While at Cybathon, Modica put the Omnia to the test on a race course mimicking daily life activities. He completed 9 out of 10 tasks in under 3 minutes. Researchers are working on refining the Omnia prototype in the lab before bringing it to market.
One of the victims of the brutal murder in California in the U.S. was honored for the last time after his organs were donated. Our North America correspondent Steve Angeles has the story.
Full of life and creativity, and even shared a musical site with his garage band Blue Point, Filipino-American Matthew Montebello was full of life and promise. Eager to continue growing about a year ago, he moved in with his Filipino-American partner, Janvi Makindang, along with his sister, Christine Akaak, and her fiancé, Edwin Garcia. Akaak was also the legal guardian of two younger siblings. All of them lived in this rented home.
He has a good heart. He has very good heart, and he's very loyal, very creative as well. He wanted to be independent. He has his own convictions about things in life, and when he moved out, and I had told him, like, if you need help, sometimes I tell him, you need some money, I would send you. And he said, no, Mom, I'm okay. I'm all right. I can do this.
Montebello just turned 21 years old on November 10th. They all celebrated as a family at his mother's house just a few miles away from their rented home. A week later, though, his life and the bright future with his family was cut short when Miguel Sandoval allegedly broke into Montebello's home, shooting 4 of the family members and 4 dogs before setting the house on fire. One of Makindang's siblings managed to hide and call police. Akaak, Makindang, and Garcia died on the scene, while Montebello was rushed to the hospital where he later died.
The house is supposed to be a safe place, and they were sleeping, and the evil person came and took matters in their own hands and in his own hand and did this to Matthew and his family, his other family, his boyfriend's family. And he's supposed to be at home asleep and safe because they were going to go to the gym the next day.
Sandoval was arrested days after the incident and had been in prison since without bail. Charged with 4 counts of special circumstance murder along with burglary and arson, a conviction could lead to a life sentence without parole. Sandoval is said to be a former boyfriend of one of Makindang's younger siblings and is scheduled to be in court in late January. While the legal proceedings are set to begin, Matthew's story is not over. Upon his passing, his organs were donated, and he was saluted with a hero's walk at the hospital.
He's a young person. He's very young and healthy. So I know that he would rather help other people, you know, instead of having his body just cremated with all the good organs, that he's still healthy organs. And I would like to think that, you know, Matthew is somehow an answered prayer to the other people who's been praying for an extension of their lives as well. So he's God's answer to some, for some people who's been praying for a heart, who's been praying for a kidney, a liver. So I want his memory to live on. And the guy who did this, the evil guy, did not succeed in extinguishing his life. He's helping, Matthew lives on. He's helping other people right now, and other people will have a chance at life now.
The family will find out in a few weeks how Matthew's body helped others. And while his donation saved many, different kinds of donors are coming to show support for the victims. Several GoFundMe accounts have opened up to help the family, and Matthew's mother said she was surprised at the amount of support and has been thankful for the prayers as well. As the events of November 16 are being pieced together and the wheels of justice begin turning, the lives lost on that evening will not be forgotten, especially Matthew, whose final heroic act will help him live on through others. Steve Angeles, ABS-CBN News, Lancaster, California.
One of the Metro's largest bus companies has launched its first fully electric buses, which will service select provincial routes for its pilot run. Will fares be cheaper? Let's find out in this report filed by Andrea Taguines.
These may look like the typical buses you ride or see on the road, but they're actually quite special, being the Philippines' first fully electric provincial commuter buses. Victory Liner unveiled the two e-buses on Wednesday as part of the company's vision to provide modern and sustainable transport options.
Pumupunta rin tayo sa ibang bansa to look at bus shows, bus conferences, and they're all discussing EV. Tapos here we come, third world country, Philippines, na parang, what's your bus? And then you answer, we're diesel. Really? Do you not have electric? Siyempre ikaw, pride mo rin to be a Filipino na hindi kami pahuhuli.
The e-buses were brought in by Chinese manufacturer Higer at a reduced price of 5 billion pesos, or more than $80,000 per unit. The charger costs another half a million pesos.
It's powered by a electric motor and direct driven na siya. So will not be emitting any carbon dioxide. So at least we makat down natin at least 100 tons of carbon dioxide per year for this unit. Yeah, just for one unit. Meron rin tong regenerating brake system. So every time na slow down, like yung sa mga traffic, it will be charging also.
ABS-CBN News, other media, and online content creators even got to join the test run. The e-bus runs like an automatic vehicle, making for an easier drive. The battery level is also displayed for everyone to see.
Wala namang something or significant na changes or difference kung sumasakay ka ng isang regular na bus. Kaibahan lang dito, hindi siya ganun katagtag.
Nakaka-relax siya, medyo nakatulog din ako.
So when can the public try it for themselves?
Starting this December, Victory Liner's two electric buses will be making two round trips at a time from its terminal in Cubao, Quezon City to San Fernando, Pampanga before they need to be recharged. A short distance trip for its trial run since there is one big roadblock to the bus company's brave new venture, which is the lack of charging stations.
Victory Liner boss Marivic Del Pilar said the ones that have been set up for electric cars are not suitable for buses, so they had to invest in their own end-to-end charging stations. Despite this, the fare stays at 141 pesos for now.
Will it make bus operations maintenance cheaper for us? If it's cheaper, di pwedeng cheaper fare, di ba? Sabi ng ating manufacturer, mas less ang maintenance cost because you don't do oil change, di ba? Ang daming hindi mo bibilin na binibili mo pag nagpa-preventive maintenance ka ng diesel engine. But magkano naman yung i-increase ng electric bill namin? Tingnan din natin. Kasi baka naman doon naman pumalo.
One incentive for private players is the no-tariff policy on EVs, which lessens the cost of importation. But The Transportation Department vowed to explore other possible government support to encourage others to follow suit.
We are talking with different companies who could fill up the void or the need for the charging stations all over the Philippines. While the foreign manufacturers are the one helping us at the moment, but definitely on the part of the government, our objective really is to have more local manufacturers do the buses or other vehicles here. Para nga, one, mas mura. Two, we give jobs to our local workers. So union and strengthen really the industry.
Victory Liner also hopes to add to its e-bus fleet and offer longer range trips so that more Filipinos will get to experience a comfortable yet eco-friendly ride. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.